competition?
Well, we've been on a plane for 32 hours with 6 hours sleep.
Guys look good.
I hope so. They look good now. I hope their legs are still underneath them halfway through the game.
Jump ball. Jump ball with Bill Bartleson in the Soviet center. 7 seconds left in the game, we've just been informed. Soviets by four, 57-53. Soviets bringing in their bigger players for help with the rebound. Soviets, this game is over, ladies and gentlemen. Actually, there's Kyle Swanson with a three-point shot. Off. And that's the ball game.
Whew. Scott was right. The game was over. And we were in desperate straits. And we could go on and show you more, but we've burned the rest of the tape. But let me take you a step further. Because the Soviets were no dummies. They knew how to schedule games. We were on that plane for 30 hours with very little sleep, and maybe 4 hours sleep at the Moscow hotel. But after rebounding a day or two, we went ahead and played the Moscow 16 and 18 year old teams, which you'll see a little bit later. But let's go a little bit further on down the road, all the way to Helsinki, where we play the junior national team, a team that's going to be representing Finland in the next 4 years. And let's see how far we really came.
Yeah.
Rick Martinez with a drive, and a basket counts as he gets fouled on his way to the hoop. Rick Martinez, number 12, with a two-point basket and a shot for a three-point play here. I was in bed by 11 o'clock, so I really don't know anything about the nightlife here. Maybe we'll have to see tonight. And Rick Martinez completes the three-point play. The Vikings lead 44-37 with 15 minutes, 28 seconds left. A foul there on number a foul on number 12. Rick Martinez gets whistled for a reach and foul. Finn's running their offense. There's a backdoor pass up high. Good. Basket off the, or ball off the rim. No good. Tony Brunello picks up the ball off after the rebound by Brian Groves. Tony Brunello goes to the hoop. Nice pass by Tony Brunello to Ryan Groves underneath for an easy layup. Tony Brunello creating things, making things happen. Oh, called a foul on number 16, Hank Castro. Coach stressing the fact that the team needs to get into the passing lanes rather than reach. Tired of seeing the fouls, does not want any more fouls. There's a fine example of breaking into the passing lane. Ryan Groves creating the steal. We got a jump ball there. As you see, a loose ball here means it's a free ball. It's like a fumble on a football field in the U.S. Anybody can jump from any angle and try and get your hand on the ball for the jump. Rick Martinez probably will lose this jump ball. He's about a foot shorter than the guy he's jumping against. Joining us here in the booth used to be number 11, but he decided to sit out this game and let the Viking team just be the Viking team without his help. He graduated 2 years ago, Michael Corcoran. How does it feel to be watching this game rather than playing?
Pretty good. This game is not as intense, I don't think, as what the past three games in Russia, where we played a lot bigger guys in Russia. It was a lot more physical game, and I think it was hard for the guys to get up for this game, knowing that, you know, they're not going to be facing the same physical abilities that the Russians had.
Okay, thanks, Michael Corcoran. Okay, we had a turnover on by Tony Brunello. Ball to the Finns here. We got 46-37, a 9-point lead in favor of the Vikes. Turnover there by the Finns. Steal by Hank Castro. Rick Martinez passes it up to Ryan Grails, who misses the layup. Trent Long gets the rebound and off the rim. No good. Ball out of bounds. Vikes ball. Some good hustle there by Trent Long, Ryan Grails, Rick Martinez, Tony Brunello, and Hank Castro. The whole squad just hustling. It looks like a completely different team. Coach must have had some good words. And Ryan Grails may have been fouled there. No call. Oh. Tony Brunello down hard to the floor. And looks like we may have a foul called. Number 15, fouling number 15 on the Finns. Ball out of bounds. Tony Brunello up, looking good. A little limp there, a little limp for the crowd. Got to see it there, boy, Tone. Okay, there's an inbound pass to Ryan Grails. Turns, shoots one-handed. Nice, nice shot by Ryan Grails. Pass, Tony Brunello. Inbound pass. Easy basket, easy basket. Vikes up now by 11 points. Down by 9 not long ago. Up by 11 now. 14 minutes left in the game. There's another turnover. Rick Martinez creates a turnover with a block deflected pass. Ball up to Trent Long, who shoots from 8 feet, and it's good. Trent Long shoots from 8 feet, and it's good.
Ricky Martinez doing a real good job for the Vikings right now on defense. He probably playing his best basketball of the whole Sylvia Tour thus far, and he's really picked it up on defense and created a couple good key turnovers for the Vikings to get some easy buckets.
Maybe it's the fact that he got some real American food last night. He ate McDonald's. Maybe he's getting a boost from the McDonald's he had. What? Okay, here's Rick Martinez running the ball, running the offense now for the Vikes after a turnover by the Finns. Down to Trent Long, three-point range, looks underneath, nothing there, back out top. Running the offense. And got a foul number 12 on the Finns, a little knee action there. Tough to defense, little Rick Martinez, quick, and has a good mind about the basketball. Brunello bringing the ball in. Backdoor to Ryan Grails again, and puts the ball down on the key, and he's fouled by number 5 for blocking. Number 5 is a foul. Getting close to the one-on-one bonus time. Taking the ball out of bounds, though. Okay, Castro to Long. Long drives, stops, pops, shoots. It's good off the backboard from 10 feet. Trent Long is just so smooth out there. Everything is real nice. Score 52-37, a 15-point lead now by the Vikes. Vikes 68-46, 5 minutes left in the half, or in the game. Vikes running the offense here. There's a pass not handled by Chris Grant, throws it away. Coach, do you think Coach Orlis thinks he has this game well in hand? He's just getting his younger players some more time?
Oh, most definitely. He needs to get some of these guys some experience, and he has a lot of guys with him, so it's hard to get everyone in. You usually play 10 in a real game where you can really develop any kind of consistency. It's hard to play 16 to 18 players. It's a good time now to let all these other guys get a shot at playing, because some of these kids will help him next year, but it's just been he's had to go with who's playing well right now.
Going up and down the court here, we called Jeff McNulty with the foul. Going to the hoop, got a charging foul. In the game now, number 8, Tony Brunello, number 7, Ryan Grails for the Vikes. Ryan Grails playing a good game here. He's got 6 points. He's got only 3 rebounds with 3 steals. We've seen a lot more rebounds from Ryan. Maybe he'll pick some up here to get back to his 8 rebounds a game average. And there's a loose ball foul, charging a player control foul at number 11. Dumped the ball off in the key and then continued into a player for a foul. In the game now for the first time, number 13, Sean Caldwell, just a junior, a little real small guy, not much strength. See how he does against these Finless point guards. Ryan Grails with a nice spin move there. He's pushed out of bounds. Second shot is also good. Vikes back on defense here. We got Ryan Grails and Tony Brunello and Scott Anger is the backcourt, or the front court, with Caldwell and Schaefer at the guards. Tony Brunello with an aggressive rebound there. Thank you. to join us inside for the start of today's game. Ladies and gentlemen, you now join us here inside the gym in Moscow in this Olympic sports arena. We are a minute or so before game time, and as you can see on the court right now, we have the Soviet team warming up with a few running sprints. This whole trip's about not only basketball, but learning about each other's cultures. I've had a very good trip up to now. We've had some tours of the Kremlin and Red Square and the economic exhibition of the Soviet Union. Moscow University was a site in itself. It's the biggest building probably most of us will ever see. They say there's enough rooms in there for a baby to be born in one room, spend a day in every room, and come out 90 years old. So that tells you how big it is. The Russian team, they had a turnover down at their offensive end of the court, and it's back to the United States. Tony Brunello with a shot at the corner of the key, gets his own rebound, shoots again and misses. Rebound to the Russians. Number 13 gets... And we got an out ball out of bounds, goes to the Soviet Union. Number 4 takes it inbounds. Like I say, we have a roster, but we really can't get the names. We had a 5-second call on the inbound play. Go turnover. United States ball. South Tahoe Vikes. Stephen Haas come bringing the ball up for the Vikes. Setting up the offense with a drive. Takes a good shot. And the tip in by Ryan Grills, number 7. Ball in. Here comes the all-familiar South Tahoe Vikings press. There it is. There's that defense we've been talking about. Coach Hughes, what are some of the keys? You talked to Coach Orlis earlier today. What are some of the keys he said to victory?
Well, first of all, they're going to have to adjust to the physical style of play and the officiating of the Soviet teams. It's a lot more physical over here, and it's just a whole different brand of basketball. A few other things, they're going to have to rebound, and they're going to have to get some post play. Last game, Stephen Haas had 20 points, and basically no one else really helped out with the scoring with the exception of Ryan Grills and Bill Bartleson. Also, defense must be a factor for the Vikings tonight because they're going to have to get some offense out of their defense to create some easy scoring opportunities. But basically, you know, just to adjust to the physical style play, because anything goes inside. They won't call a foul on offensive rebounds. Therefore, they're just going to have to bang with them the whole game.
Thank you, Coach. We have a foul on the play. It's foul is on number 8, Tony Brunello, his first. We have a 2-0 score right now in favor of the United States, South Tahoe Vikings. And like you said, here's some of that defense Coach Hughes was talking about. And an easy shot for the Soviet team. Drops for 2 points. Tie game 2-2. Okay, here comes the fast break. Oh, we got a little foul there. Contact number 4 on the Soviet team. Should be a shooting foul. We'll have to see. No, he calls it taking it out of bounds. Bill Bartleson to take it out of bounds for the Vikings. There's Stephen Haas driving to the hoop with a driving shot and a foul. Number 20, no shot. And drives in tough with against the big man. Ryan Grills with the rebound. No, goes off to Rick Martinez on the rebound. Stephen Haas gets the ball, shoots, no good. Bartleson with the rebound, and he's fouled for a shot at a 3-point play.
That's probably the most physical possession we've had as a team. It seemed like there's about 5 fouls. Nothing was called, and it ended up good for us because Bill Bartleson just put down a 2-pointer and also got fouled, so it worked out in our favor this time.
And completes the 3-point play.
That was a 3-point play.
Okay, the Viking defense seems to be picking up really well. Coach is screaming right at him, right in their face the whole time if you can't hear him. There's a block by Trent Long, throws it out of the court. Trent Long just hustling all over the court. Okay, we got Soviet ball inbounds. That's got to be 5-second, 5. And the 5-second is called. U.S. ball, we got a substitution here with Kyle Swamps.
5-second call there, and this is a different Viking team than 2 days ago. I think the kids are really starting to pick it up now. Their energy levels seem to be high, and I think jet lag is now a hidden factor. It's not there anymore. As of right now it is 1 a.m. our time.
There's a nice defensive rebound by Trent Long. Again, just showing that he is tougher than Coach Orlich has been giving him credit for. There's a slamming dunk! And it counts! Stephen Haas slammed with a foul, a chance at a 3-point play. What a game for Stephen. Tip controlled by Stephen Hess. Corcoran off to Jason Alley. Is that combination again the other way? Assist by Corcoran, basket by Alley. That's that state championship combination, folks. They did it for that year. They're doing it now. We may have a 10-second here. Turnover to Chris Grant. Out to Jason Alley. Stops, drives, pops, shoots. No good. Number 20, Stephen Hess on the offensive board, and he goes in and got fouled. This looks like a very good Viking team running right now. Foul on number 9 on the Soviet Union. Stephen Hess will have 2 shots at the free throw line here. Basket by Stephen Hess. Stephen Hess makes both, and that looks good to have him to make both. It looks to be 58-40. I don't know, we really can't tell. Vikings are up by about 6 points, I imagine. Soviet lose the ball out of bounds, goes Mike Corcoran inbound. Jason Alley shoots short. That's what happens when you don't play much. Rebound by Hess, battling for it, and he gets fouled, and it goes! Stephen Hess just playing incredible ball, folks. Hustled after that ball on the ground, picks it up, shoots it up, gets hacked. Chance for a 3-point play.
Beautiful play in there by Stephen. He is just doing everything for the Vikings today. But the team as a whole has been playing real hard and real Tom Orlich basketball. They've been playing hard, and the last game, they weren't themselves. And I mean, there's no excuses, but so be it. You're on the plane for 36 hours. That's the way it goes.
Stephen Hess converts a 3-point play. Viking defense again knocking the ball out of bounds into our ball. Viking defense is just doing it all here. Corcoran into Rick Martinez, back to Corcoran. Down low to Grant. Goes up strong, gets the ball blocked. Passes off and is stolen. Okay, here we go. Viking D is back. Looks like a little travel, no call. Out of bounds, U.S. ball. And here they come on that fast break offense. Jason Alley running. Uh-oh, got picked clean. Should be an easy basket for the Soviet, and he makes it. Layup there for the Soviet team. Number 11, Jason Alley bringing it up. This time goes behind his back, gets by that defender. Gets a nice dish. No good by Chris Grant. He made that look bad. Soviet ball back up the middle of the court, slowly on a walk. Jason Alley playing some good D here. La push, no call. Number 4 shoots and makes it for the Soviets. Another 2 points. Soviet team appears to have 49. Corcoran with a driving layup blocked out of his hand. Ball goes back to the Soviet Union. Appears to be the score is 61-49 in favor of the United States. Another defensive play by Stephen Hess, just doing so much. Ball goes to Mike Corcoran, who assists it up to Rick Martinez on a beautiful pass. Bounce pass, Rick Martinez goes in, goes for the side hook and misses the ball. A beautiful pass by Mark Corcoran on that steal. Rick Martinez plays a good D on the pickoff there. Good defense there by Rick Martinez and Jason Allen. In comes substitutes for the United States. Number 7, Ryan Girls in for Chris Grant. And 2 big men come in. 2 big men in for the Soviet Union. Bill Bartleson wants checking in now. He's going to go in for Jace Alley. There's a steal by Rick Martinez and almost. Can't do it. Okay, got substitution confusion here. Again, U.S. ball on a turnover there. Got Bill Bartleson in for Stephen Hess and Kyle Swanson in for Jason Alley. Jason Alley did a fine job. As you can say, he didn't stay in very long. He hasn't been playing much as well.
Jason really did a nice job in there for about 3 minutes. He helped in that little spurt. Nice pass there to Mike Corcoran. Nice shot. Rick Martinez with a nice assist to Mike Corcoran.
Stephen Hess, Trent Long, and Tom Orlich of the South Tahoe Vikings. Stephen, you had an incredible game again. After the first game of 20 points, this time you broke the 40-point barrier with quite a few rebounds. Excellent defensive game. Any comments on the style of play between the first game and this one?
We just played, everybody was fluent this game. The first game, nobody was together. Everybody played a lot harder, a lot smoother. Everybody was, we played as a team a lot better.
And that's exactly what we saw. Thank you. And Trent Long, coach been giving you a hard time since we left on this trip and probably all summer about not being very tough. Today you came out and you battled. You had, I'm sure you're in the about right around 10 rebounds and you were battling tough. You got 4 fouls in between. You were slapping people as well. Any comments for the coach?
I knew I could do it all along.
If you didn't hear that, he said he knew he could do it all along, and it's the confident smile. I like the dunk you went up for, and you missed that. Any comments on that?
I almost had it.
Okay, now we got Coach Orlich. Any comments on the game? I'm sure you got some good things to say, probably some bad too as a coach. What are your comments?
Well, we were pleased that we won. It was a big difference between this game and the last game. We knew that it was going to be very physical. We knew we had to battle much harder. And what happened was our kids adjusted to how physical a game it was over here. And they adjusted to the rule change. They adjusted to the officials. And I'm pleased with all the adversity they overcame. And they're really a lot tougher now than they were 2 days ago.
Okay, thank you, Tom Ortiz, Trent Long, and Stephen Hass. Good game, and we'll see you in a couple days. Okay, this is Scott Shahadi and Andy Hughes signing off for KMTN TV8 Tahoe Paradise. Thank you.
One, two, three, four.
You're ruining all my fun. One, two, three, four.
Okay, keep talking.
One of our top celebrities here from the USA, Scott Shahadi. Scott, do you have a word for the camera here?
Testing. One, two, three.
Intelligent. Intelligent.
You got to be official here. Hi, this is Scott Shahadi again, live in Leningrad here in the USSR. We've been in Leningrad now for approximately 20 hours or so. A little different accommodations than we were arranged with in Moscow to tell about the differences. I'm going to have you talk to Tony Brunello here. Tony's going to talk about the games. Hank Castro is going to talk about the concert we went to last night. And Chase Steadman here is going to talk to you about the differences in the accommodations between Moscow and Leningrad.
Can't Chase talk about the concert?
No. Chase can't talk about the concert. He missed the concert last night due to a screw-up in the time arrangement between meeting our bus and I. We left him.
Well, you know, Orlitz really tried to psych us out on the time on the motel accommodations. He told us that it was going to be horrible, you know. He said we were going to have bed bugs and mosquitoes, cockroaches and everything. This motel is great, you know. The one in Moscow, you know, was decent. This one's much better than the hotel in Moscow. You know, there's one bathroom to the hotel room. This is much better, I'd have to say, Scott. This is, you know, this is great. It's almost as good as America.
What he's talking is we were in a student housing in Moscow, which was much less than your basic student dorm in the United States. And here we have our own apartment. It's like it's almost like a vacation here. Hank Castro, we went and saw a concert last night, a little folk music, folk dance. Would you mind describing that to our American public?
Yes, yeah, so it was beautiful. It was a great show. I mean, everybody was very talented. The things that you saw that we got on camera, you won't believe it. It's a once-in-a-lifetime experience, and, you know, you had to be there to really, you know, feel the excitement, and, you know, everybody was, you know, just, it was great.
I'm speechless.
The concert was put on by the Ukrainian people, and I think they did it just for us, I'm not sure. Tony Brunello, you've had a couple of very good games so far, a little aggressive play. You might explain the differences between a game you're used to in the United States, a high school competition, say, against, say, Carson City or something, and a game against these Moscow folks.
Well, these guys are a lot more tougher. They usually push you around a lot more, and in Tahoe, it's more a lot more slower. But here, this game just picks up really quick, and everybody's just jamming down the court the whole time, so you got to switch a lot more, and everything's just a lot quicker. And some of the guys, well, we played one night, played with some real big guys, and they're just humongous. And so we really got to toughen up on that game. So we've done a pretty good job, I'd say, just coming together. So.
Okay, Jay, would you mind expanding on what you expect from the teams here in Leningrad? We're going to play two games against two different teams from the same institute of sport. Do you mind, you know, commenting on that?
Well, I expect the games to be very much similar to the ones in Moscow, you know. All the play here is really tough, like Tony said. It's going to be real aggressive, and we're going to have a tough time, you know. I just hope we can pull it out.
All right, thanks, guys. Why don't you sharpen up your elbows and get ready for some tough games. This is Scott Shahadi with Hank Castro, Chase Steadman, and Tony Brunello live in Leningrad. Welcome. This is Scott Shahadi again here in Leningrad. Right now we're on the River Neva, which is the main waterway between Leningrad and the Baltic Sea. You can also catch this river for transport of people, passengers, or freight to the Mediterranean area. In front of us here, which you can't get a picture of right now due to the light, is the actual ship that started the Russian Revolution back in 1914. This battleship fired the first shot on Nicholas II, and at this time in history, Lenin, who's the start of the Communist Party here in Russia, was in exile in Europe, but he came across once the revolution started to help the cause and to turn the country back towards communism. I'm here with Brian Bornstein and Ryan Grells. Ryan had an excellent first two games, rebounding and added a few points as well. And Brian is going to comment about the differences here between the Russian buildings here in Leningrad and Moscow. Technological differences or anything that he has noticed so far, Brian?
Yeah, well, I think that the differences here is I think it's a lot nicer of a place. It's right on the ocean, and I think there's not as much smog here. I think it's a lot clearer, and it's just a nicer place to be. I enjoy it a lot better, even though we've only been here for a day, 24 hours now, and I enjoy it. There's a lot of buildings, and
the buildings here seem to be a little newer, a little more modern. Have you noticed the same thing with the people themselves?
Not really. We haven't really been on the street too long yet, so I haven't really noticed any differences between the people or any of that sort of the matter.
Last night at the concert, we saw a couple of young ladies. Would you mind describing them to the people?
Oh, yeah. Too bad all the Russian ladies weren't like that.
That's the truth. By far, they were the best ladies we've seen so far. In Moscow, they weren't the prettiest things, but these two sure were fine here in Leningrad. Ryan, you got a couple of excellent games clearing the boards and starting a fast break for the Vikings, as well as playing some defensive gems against some of the bigger players here. Do you have anything you're doing differently or anything you want to tell us about?
Well, it's just it's a lot more aggressive game. And they push and shove and hack, so when we come back to the States, I think we'll be ready for some pretty heavy competition.
Are you sharing in this pushing, shoving, and hacking bit and getting away with it just as the Russians are?
Oh, yeah, you bet. They don't see much.
Well, that's it from Ryan Girls. It tells you just exactly how tough it is underneath the glass in these games. And right, like I say, we're on the river here, River Neva in Leningrad, in front of the battleship that started the Russian Revolution back in 1914. No, it's called River Neva. Oh, the ship is called the Aurora. Our cameraman here, Mike Conway, from KMTN TV8 in Leningrad. This is Scott Shahadi. Thank you. Okay, this is Scott Shahadi. Now I'm on the battleship here in the River Neva. I'm with Eric Schinzing, and he's going to tell you the significance of this battleship here in Leningrad.
Well, this is the ship that started the revolution in 1914 against Nicholas II and started the new era of Lenin.
And Lenin was in Europe on exile at this point, and he came over to Russia to start and help with the revolution and to end up becoming the starter of the Communist Party here in Russia. Would you mind commenting on anything about that? How do you feel about Lenin? Or do you see his picture everywhere in the city and the significance of Lenin?
Lenin is like almost worshipped here. You can't go anywhere without really seeing him. His statues, his portraits, or anything.
Well, that's the truth. Everywhere you turn, you see a good picture of the leader Lenin here. Even in Moscow, as you most know, there was a his tomb is lined up. There's lines for hours to see his tomb every day in Moscow in the Red Square. Okay, this is Eric Schinzing here, and I'm Scott Shahadi signing off for now. We'll see you later. joining me right now is Scott Attinger. He's a junior on this year's South Tahoe team. Behind us, Scott, is a monument that was built in the 18th century. Would you mind commenting on what exactly it is?
The bows of the ships and stuff were put on there for, I guess, from the sailors and stuff, as a monument so they could see to get in here from the sea or something like that.
The light on the top was to help people to navigate this river on their way to the Baltic Sea. What exactly is the this column here and the one down the way a little bit, what is it put up for?
For the revolution, I'm pretty sure.
Okay, Scott Attinger thinks it's for the revolution, and he is correct, as according to our tour guide, Natasha. Right now, I'm going to call in Tom Orlich, the head basketball coach here. He's going to comment on the Winter Palace, which was the home of Nicholas II, and he's going to give us a little information on the Winter Palace itself. Coach?
Tom. Well, right now, I'm looking at the Winter Palace, and when we just left the battleship, they fired on the Winter Palace, where Nicholas II at the time was in power, and he had 5,000 servants. And what they did was they captured him, and they went ahead and took Nicholas II and the royal family to the Ural Mountains and kept the royal family there until the end of the revolution in 1918. And at that time, they went ahead and took the royal family downstairs in the cellar and shot them all so that there would be no one that could claim the throne. And all nobility was killed and assassinated during that time to be sure no one did claim power. And the mark of Lenin then went ahead and took its hold here in the Soviet Union. Very fascinating.
Thank you, Coach. Also across the river is the Peter and Paul Fortress, a very famous building here, which when it was completed and opened up to be lived in by Peter and Paul was 1703, which was the actual opening date of the city of Leningrad. We'll get to that more later when we do have a tour of that. Thank you for now, and we'll see you later.
Well, Rick, this is our last few minutes in Leningrad. What are your thoughts as we leave the airport?
Well, I'm just happy to be going home, even though I had a good time over here, but I'd like to get back over into Helsinki and get some real food.
Well, what was wrong with the food, Rick? Did you enjoy the borscht?
The what?
Borscht. The cabbage and beet soup.
No, it wasn't too good. I don't like any of the food.
How about the meat and potatoes?
The potatoes were good. I didn't eat too much of the meat.
How about the salmon?
Didn't eat the salmon.
How about the caviar?
Didn't try the caviar either.
How about those Russian women, Rick?
they were all right, I guess.
Do they measure up to Michelle Franzoya? Well, we gotta leave Rick right now. We're gonna come on over here to Kyle. Kyle, what'd you think of the Soviet Union?
Oh, I thought it was okay. I enjoyed myself.
Okay. I mean, how about St. Basil's Cathedral?
It was pretty interesting. I enjoyed it.
Well, how about the prison for the unwanted wives? Should we have that in the United States, you think?
Yes, I think we should.
How about that prison for the unwanted teenagers? How about that?
We could do without that.
Well, what are your thoughts of going into Helsinki? What are you looking forward to most of all?
The food and the water.
How about those blonde women?
How about them?
All right, this is Coach Orlich from Leningrad Live signing off. And Chris, what would be your most memorable moment in the Soviet Union? Now, we're including Moscow and Leningrad.
That big museum we went to today, Hermitage.
What did you like the most of the Hermitage?
That it's the end of our trip and we get back to Helsinki.
Well, what is it that you found most distracting about the Soviet Union? What didn't you like about it?
That they're 30 years behind, and that they just don't realize how much what they can do to be better.
Well, for example?
They all smoke.
You don't like the smoking?
No.
How about the food?
It's good for them, I guess, but I'm gonna be glad to get back and eat some of ours.
Well, how about their clothes?
A lot different from us. It seems like they're 30 years behind in those too.
What are you looking forward to in Helsinki?
Women.
How about the Russian players? What did you think of them? Would you like to play like them?
Yeah, but not all the time. They play tough and over the back a lot. a lot of fouls. That's good, but then it's fun to play like that, but I'd rather play than we do in America.
Do you think you learned something from the Russian players?
Yeah.
What?
To be tougher.
Good. Then our trip was worthwhile. Sign off here in Leningrad.
Like what? Okay, I have Scott Shahadi here at the Leningrad Airport. We're hours away from jumping on the plane and flying out of the Soviet Union for the end of our Soviet part of the trip with Helsinki to come forward. Joining me here is Jeff McNulty, Sean Caldwell, and Jason Schaefer. Jason, some of the guys were saying you had a crush on our first tour guide in Moscow, Tanya. And I didn't know if whether or not to believe it, and I was watching your actions. You seemed to be with her as much as possible. Is that for informational purposes?
Yes, strictly.
Or were you just in love?
Strictly informational purposes, I must say.
Well, since it was so much informational, what kind of information can you share with our viewers back in Lake Tahoe that you learned from her? Maybe her address?
They want that, I guess. Not much other that I can talk about.
Square.
About Red Square?
What kind of things about Red Square? Maybe the Kremlin? You got anything to share? The number of towers or the ones with stars on them in the Red Square?
There are 20 towers in Red Square. 5 of them have stars on them.
And the 5 stars mean what?
The 5 tallest.
The 5 tallest.
Well, that's Jason Schaefer's history, and you could tell he was not in love. It was all informational with our tour guide, Tanya. Okay, Sean Caldwell, we're standing right behind us here. Directly behind us is one of the Russian vehicles, and in the window there is a hat. Did you see any of those hats on the black market, and if so, did you get one of those?
Yeah, I got one for my little brother. Mostly all the military folks have them.
Okay, that hat there, was it that exact hat, or was it a different army hat?
I think it was a general hat, but I'm not sure.
Okay, what one thing in Russia so far, Moscow, either Moscow or Leningrad, has really stood out in your mind and really impressed you or depressed you?
One thing I noticed mostly was all the cars were the same, mostly all really square and stuff.
Now, did you find anything about the cars? Is that a social status to have a nicer one, or is it just what you can afford?
I guess it's just what you can afford.
Sean Caldwell, noticing the vehicles here in Moscow and Leningrad. And now we're with Jeff McNulty. Jeff, you got some playing time on the court here. You were in there banging it with the big boys. A few shots. You know, what do you have to comment about the games themselves?
I thought they were fun. Good experience.
Did you enjoy the banging? Are you a rough player? Do you enjoy the banging? Or would you rather have a little more finesse like we may be used to in the States?
Well, I wasn't used to the banging, but it was fun, and I liked it because I like to bang because I play football, so.
The past two games in Moscow, we had some unfavorable officiating, maybe is the best way to call it, or inconsistent. Do you have any comments on that?
No. They were bad.
They were bad, but it didn't bother you? Not at all? You just continued to play your type of game?
There was nothing we can do about the calls, so I just went along with it.
A true sportsman attitude. That's what I like to see. Scott Shahadi in Leningrad signing off. On the Soviet point guard, there's Steven Hask. Turned by Rick Martinez, gets the ball out to Ryan Grells, pushing it up, cross court to Steven Hask, who drives and shoots off the backboard for 2 for Steven Hask. Vikings back on defense as well, running much better, 44-40 in favor of the Soviets. There's an inside pass, nice pass, no good. Rebound Ryan Grells, out to Steven Hask, running the offense, there's Trent Long on the corner for 2, shoots it, it's good! Trent Long brings the Vikings within 2 points. Here's that Viking press now, getting ready to turn the double team, jump switch. There's Steven Hask making a great effort at the ball, gets the ball, pass off to Trent Long, pump fake, there's... And it's a technical foul as the ball goes down! Trent Long with a pump fake, gets the Soviet shooter to be painting the ceiling, hangs on the rim for a technical foul, and the basket counts. Tie game right now with the Vikings at the line to go for the lead. Andy.
Hey, that was a great spurt, and that's just what the Vikings needed to get back in the game. Trent Long's at the line for the 2-shot technical, but everything picked up. There's about an 8-point run within a minute there.
And he misses both shots. Ball almost out of bounds there. Vikings playing some very hustling D, and we have a foul on number 7, Ryan Crows.
Free throws again become a factor. They just missed two, so thus far this half, they're 1-for-4, and they could have just gone up two, and they just can't get over the hump. They can't get the lead in the game. I hope to see them get the lead, and maybe they'll become more comfortable with it.
Okay, a shot by the Soviet shooters, no good. Okay, joining us now with our tour guide and interpreter is Natasha, and we'd like to get the name of the Soviet player.
His name is Sergei. He was player number 4. Sergei Panov. His family name is Panov.
Okay, Sergei, we'd like to ask you what you were thinking before the game when you thought you had your first chance to play against a United States team.
Какие ваши были впечатления или представления о том, что будет во время игры до того, как вы начали играть сегодняшний матч?
Я думал, что мы легко выиграем. Ребята показались не очень высокие такие, но очень хорошо в процессе игры узнал, что хорошо тактически подготовлены, хорошая техника, тактика. Ну и поэтому игра была такой напряженной. Мы не ожидали такого. Думали, команда слабее.
So when they knew that it would be a match today, so they thought that they would win. But when they saw the boys, they understand that the same because they're younger. But when they started the play, they understand that tactics and the coaching and training is much better with your group whereas the Soviet one.
Well, now that you're done playing, you've seen international ball, and do you think that our kids have adjusted to international ball well enough to compete at an international level?
Вопрос такой. Значит, вы увидели ребят, которые не играют в хоккей на уровне страны. Как вы считаете, есть ли у них шансы? Могут ли они стать в национальной сборной?
Какой
страны? США.
Я не знаю, как остальные ребята. Остальных я не видел.
Well, the problem is that he just saw this team. And he didn't saw a national team of the United States. I mean, he didn't play with. But he said that they have the opportunity, I mean, the chance, you know.
Okay, we'd like to thank Sergei and Natasha, and good luck in the future, and we'll see you later.
Thank you. But he says that in Soviet national team, they could be best players.
All right, well, it's good to see you out here, and we'll see you later. Thank you. That's Sergei, one of the Soviet players.
Between the pages of my mind, memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Quiet thoughts come floating down and settle softly to the ground like gold of autumn leaves around my feet. I touch them and they burst apart with sweet memories. Sweet memories of holding hands and red bouquets and twilights trimmed in purple haze and laughing eyes and simple ways and quiet nights and gentle days with you. Pages of my mind. Memories sweeten through the ages just like wine.